thanks for showing up.
Oh man, there is a lot of people here.
They're excited. They want the 10th anniversary news.
I'm going to introduce all the important people now. First up is the senior editor of Dynamite, the guy who is the glue to help put everything together, Mr. Joseph Ryband. Give him a big hand. And someone very, very, very special to this, Reggie Hudlin, the producer of Django Unchained. Ain't he good looking? Now we have the Eisner Award winning, and many other awards. So proud to say this, Matt Wagner. In about 2 minutes, you're only going to want to talk to Matt and Quentin, so, you know, I'm getting in as much as I can. And last but not least, of course, the man who makes it all happen, Mr. Quentin Tarantino. Thank you to Alan for helping to come and help moderate this, because I would flub it the whole way, so that's good. And we know many of you are here thanks to our special guest and this awesome project. It's historic. We're so fortunate, Reggie's going to get into it in a little bit, but that we were able to do the first sequel of any Quentin Tarantino movie ever as a comic book. It's really great because this is our 10th anniversary. It was 10 years ago, literally this past Wednesday, when Army of Darkness first shipped. And we've had Army of Darkness, Red Sonja, Vampirella, the Chaos Line characters, Lone Ranger, Boy, Zorro, let me name a few more. Now, we put out a lot of great comics, a lot of great creators, and we can only do it thanks to you guys, because without your support, without your being our avid fans, we wouldn't be able to do any of this. So, thank you, and cheers to yourself. I think one of the things that we're really going to get to be able to talk about here is that when you've got two great visionaries like Matt and Quentin working on a comic, comics are pure labors of love, unlimited budget. It's just making sure you have the right collaboration, the right artist working with you, pulling what you have in your mind, pulling it and working with you and making it the best it can be. And, you know, I've got nothing else to say, but thank you to everybody, and take it away, Alan.
I mean, the first question is really pretty simple, and anyone jump in to talk about this. Who the heck approached who about doing this in the first place?
That's you, Reggie.
Yes. Hey, everybody.
Ain't he handsome?
So, Quentin and I are at dinner. I say, Quentin, here's an idea. What do you think? Django meets Zorro. And Quentin said,
I love the idea. I mean, one of the things about it that I like so much was the fact that not only do I like Western comics in general, grew up reading Western comics, is I've also really also loved Zorro and all the different incarnations of Zorro, whether it be the Guy Madison, Guy Williams, Disney show, whether it be the William Whitney Zorro's Fighting Legion, whether it be all the different movies of it. And the thing that I, you know, thought was just such a great idea was the idea of taking like the most famous fictional Mexican Western hero and putting him with one of the newer famous Black fictional Western heroes and putting them together and having them fight oppression more around California, Arizona way.
It's a beautiful thing. Or else, as Quentin said, when I threw the idea to him, he said, they both had O at the end of their names.
Yes.
I said, yes. And he said, black and brown fight together. One of the many, many things I love about Quentin is that I don't have to hide my political agenda because it's the same as his.
Yeah, right.
So he was excited for the same reason I was, that this was the coolest idea ever. So I called Nick. I said, let's do this. Now, Nick then provided us with the vast array of the great Dynamite library. Mm-hmm. And Quentin plunged in. And he really loved Matt Wagner's work on Zorro, which who doesn't?
Yeah.
He's an extraordinary writer, brilliant, an amazing body of work.
Now, I think if they were to literally just take Matt's books the way they are just right now, and just did it as a TV series, it would be the best Zorro TV series ever made.
Oh, it's awesome.
Anybody?
Quentin, Reggie, shall I take it to the rights holders? You guys want to produce it?
Things can be checked. So Quentin did something I actually, it was very, he said, hey, let's work with this guy. This guy's a great writer. I said, I agree. And one of the great pleasures was the day that Matt flew into Los Angeles and we all met at Quentin's house and the brainstorming began. And I have to say, watching these two fantastic minds, both steeped in history, both well-known and obscure, and fantastic storytellers, and watching them weave their love of Django and Zorro into an exquisite, well, you'll just see it for yourself. The work, I knew that this was going to be not just historical, because Quentin was actually extending the life of one of his brilliant creations, but it was going to be a collaboration for the ages. So I'm as excited as you are as I read the scripts and know that this is going to be a fantastic book.
Yeah, and I have to say that first meeting that Reggie's talking about there, when I flew down to get together with Quentin, you know, I was a little curious as to how this is going to work out. You know, I'm kind of a singular edition creator, and so is Quentin, and didn't know how that would mesh, you know. Quentin might be an asshole, I might be an asshole, you don't know.
Yeah.
And it turned out, I mean, it just felt like we've kind of known each other for years.
Oh, no, absolutely.
We're about the same age, we have the same points of reference, we love the same stuff, and it was just kind of like, boom, let's roll.
Well, you know, it's actually, one of the things that was actually really interesting about it was, you know, I'm looking at, well, I mean, first, I was like, well, we'll take care of Django when we get to it. This has got to work as a Zorro book.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, as the next extension of the Zorro book. And you're going to be the, those are your Bibles. All right, so I'm looking to him as the Zorro expert. However, I have seen a lot of the different Zorro or Zorro-ish type of movies and serials over the course of the years. And then, when I heard about the idea of Zorro Django, I started rewatching some of them and trying to brainstorm. So I was like, well, hey, what do you think about this? And maybe we could attack the story this way. But you know, it's like, you know, you're gonna know what's best as far as Zorro is concerned. But let me show you these ideas and whatever. And then literally, it was just kind of one foot in front of the other. Oh, that's a great idea. Let's do this. Let's do that. But we watched about like 3 hours of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. When you start working with people, you like to screen movies for them.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, we're going to watch movies all weekend. Okay, all right, great. And so we watched a bunch of great movies and kicked around a bunch of great ideas. And everything just started to flow. Just ideas were popping. I said to you, there was a lot of, yes, I love that, flying back and forth across the table.
And the thing with Django is, I don't know if I'll ever do a movie sequel to it, but if I did, it would kind of, you know, it would have to be connected to something to the first movie in kind of an epic kind of way. But I always did love the idea of there being, and me and Reggie talked about it, there being like Django paperbacks. You know, just like the further adventures of them.
That's brand new.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And, or, you know, Splintering in a Mind's Eye or something. It's its own little adventure. But when we actually went to talk to people about doing them, I could never just let go. I couldn't just let go and let some guy do it, and you know, I'd read their synopsis like, oh, you're effing up the mythology, that's not what Django would do, and Schultz actually really doesn't feel that way. So I did want to do something like that, but I knew I just couldn't quite let it go. And this was the perfect opportunity to me. And also, I was so happy with the way the Django Unchained comic book came out that I was like, oh, no, I think this is the way to follow the story.
Yeah, and again, as you can tell, I mean, when Quentin and I first started hanging out 15 or so years ago, you know, before whatever main, well, I guess you were prepping for Inglourious, right?
Yeah,
I mean, that was still in the works. We watched Zorro shorts before the main features, so.
Yeah. For Inglourious?
Yeah. Right.
I have like all, you know, 13 chapters. So when I would show a movie, I would try to get through a new serial. So I would just, every time I show a film, I show the next chapter of the serial.
Exactly. And one of the things, I mean, after Django, you know, Quentin and I had, you know, spent basically every day together for 2 years. Right? So after the movie was over, I was like, okay, let's go back to our lives.
Yeah.
And then he called and said, hey, man, a friend of mine just gave me his comic collection. So we went over and we just had all these great long walks and we just read comics for an afternoon.
Right, yeah, exactly.
But it was exquisite, so it just got us back in the comic book head.
Yeah, well, in fact, the first time I was there, Quentin had, it was a year ago, just post-San Diego, Quentin had just been to San Diego, and you had bought up stacks and stacks of the Marvel black and white mags from the 70s.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Like, you know, Dracula Lives, Tales of the Zombie, Savage Sword of Conan, Deadly Hands of Kung Fu. And that's my era too. And you have to remember, those of you a little too young, you know, those magazines were put out at the time to escape the comics code. And they weren't racked with regular comics. They were always on the upper magazine racks in the magazine stores. And so as a 13-year-old, they felt really dangerous and illicit.
Yeah.
You know? And you'd go over and you'd like take one of your shoulders and see if you watch it. And so we geeked out of there. Those.
Oh yeah, well, just
an hour probably.
Well, as we got together, I had just completely reconnected with my love of 70s era comics and started following some characters that I hadn't read when I was younger. But I sort of fell in love with Morbius the Living Vampire. Read everything, and I fell in love with Tigra the Werewolf.
Tigra, yeah.
Love Tigra the Werewolf. All right, you know. And, I'm plowing through West Coast Avengers right now to finish her arc. So I was all involved with all of that, and it was just the perfect time to go over and brainstorm a story.
Yeah, yeah.
So for my second question. Are we that far ahead already? So, I mean, we talked a little bit about this. Zorro has met other people in the Dynamite universe. He's a version of him is with the Shadow. He had a team up with the Lone Ranger. How is this team up going to be different for what we've seen with Zorro team up so far? And also, how do you blend the atmospheres of the two characters? Or was that even a challenge?
That's not a challenge because they both fight oppression. They both are opposed to oppression. They both face it in different fashions, but oppression's the big deal for both of them.
Right.
Certainly, Django's approach to it is a little more personal, a little more deadly. Zorro's is a little more.
He doesn't blow up people quite as often.
Right. Zorro's is a little more. Sure. Yeah, why don't you go?
The biggest difference between this team up and the other team ups is
when I first went down, I thought, okay, well, Django takes place 4 years before the Civil War.
Yeah.
Maybe? So we're Civil War era. And of course, Zorro's in his prime around 1915, 1912. I thought, well, we're going to have a legacy Zorro. We're going to have a new Zorro. And so I went down with some ideas about how we would affect that, and Quentin just shot that right down. He's like, no, I want Zorro to be old. I want to have old Zorro. And so we very much have a kind of, you know, Luke and Obi-Wan sort of.
Yeah, no, I was very much like, no, he's got to be your Zorro.
Yeah,
we can't make him do Zorro up.
Right. Because
Diego. Everything that happened had to happen, you know.
In our world.
Yeah.
And immediately that just all of a sudden worked for me. We figured out, for instance, one of the things Quentin brought up was that after years and years and years of posing as the kind of foppish Don Diego de la Vega, he kind of has become Don Diego de la Vega. That's become his reality. He's a little fastidious, he's a little old, he, he likes his cucumber sandwiches and everything neat and tidy.
He's
and
very committed to tea time.
Yep. And that just
his prairie perfume.
Yes. And that just that provides a terrific new aspect to Zorro's character. Some great opportunity for comedy in the midst of drama. And yet he's still the firm badass fighting for justice. You know, Zorro.
Yeah, don't get us wrong. He puts on his costume and kicks ass.
Yes.
He's not.
Zorro's cry is, you know, justice for all, and that is where he goes and why he does what he does.
So, we also have a little bit of artwork here.
Should we show up?
I think the audience might have stuff that they want to ask us.
Whoa.
So, you might have noticed a microphone.
You're not going to ask about the story or anything?
I think the audience probably has questions about the story.
Okay.
We hope.
If not, we're going to tell you.
Right. Although quickly, though, it is going to be how many issues?
Six issues.
And what's the ending?
Zorro and Django kick ass.
Yeah. You, Mr. Tarantino, have any hand in drawing? Like, because I know you're not like a stranger to animation. Like, I know Kill Bill or Ren.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Do you draw anything like on napkins or like filters?
You know, it was actually funny. 20 years ago, when I was going around, I never was able to draw at all when I was younger. But a friend of mine actually was a pretty good little sketch artist, and he kind of started teaching me how to draw a little bit. And when I was going around the world, on the film festival circuit with Reservoir Dogs, I actually really started kind of getting into it, and I would send people these postcards, and I'd do a drawing. Basically, the only thing I can do is I can do a caricature of myself. And so,
because the mirror is always there.
Yeah, so from time to time, I've kind of figured out how to do it. And yeah, and so from time to time, I don't dry up myself with keen eyes, all right? But I would, from time to time, I'll do it on an autograph or something. But like during that trip, I would always, you know, if I would be in England, it was like, you know, me dressed as a bobby, all right? Yeah, or me on a double-decker bus. Or if I was in Scotland, it would be like me in a kilt riding Nessie. All right, so. But you know, oddly enough, it all kind of went away. I had a big burst of it, and then it just kind of
got
went
out of use.
Yeah, I can still kind of do that one little caricature, but for that year I was doing it, but then when I stopped doing it, it kind of just evaporated.
Yeah. It's like a music instrument. You don't do it every day.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, honey.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
My question's for Quentin, obviously.
Oh, we can just go.
You make everybody else feel bad.
I'm going to have to ask everyone a question now. Given that John Travolta and Michael Madsen are both too old to do the Vega Brothers prequel now, any ideas about maybe doing it as a comic book or any other comic books you might start?
Oh, wow. Yes, please.
Actually, I haven't had that idea before until you put it in my head. I think
that'll have to go in the old brain pan. We'll see. Good morning,
Hi. Good afternoon. Wow, I'm pretty excited about talking to you. I'm a very big fan, and actually today it's my birthday.
So hey!
Yeah, so I have a very similar question to the guy right up before me. Since you're now getting into this comic business, and you have a lot of material with a lot of characters, with a lot of backstories that we don't know much about, only you in your head, you know all the stories of all of them. I was wondering if you're going to say something about Dr. King Schultz, for example.
Oh, excellent. I wouldn't be too surprised if in a flashbacky kind of form, Dr. Schultz doesn't make an appearance in Django Tarn.
Non-linear, standard non-linear sort of storytelling.
And actually, what's going on with that actually is I wrote this one scene that I really, really liked in for the film, but I didn't even ever put it in the finished script because the script was already too long as it was. But I always liked it. It was just like, you know how you show
Schultz's modus operandi, how he comes into town and turns up everything and then kind of always talks his way out. Well, I had one more of those that I really liked, but we didn't need it. But I always liked the scene. And so when I was talking to Matt, I go, why don't we just take this whole scene, you know, just the way I wrote it, just kind of stick it in as a flashback. And he's like, oh, that's great.
Yeah, it's terrific, too. It's great. Yeah.
Now,
but in keeping with that, like, I want to see Jules walking the earth.
Yeah, right.
I want to see Marty Green's daughter come back.
The origin of Bill.
Yeah. So, how about it? Anybody up for that? Yeah. So,
Hanzo and Pai Mei.
Along those lines, I mean, we can talk about this as a sequel. Is this a sequel that takes place like a week later, or you know?
No, it takes place. They're both older.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, then.
But it's we're just on the cusp of the Civil War. It hasn't quite happened yet.
Yeah.
One thing I guess let's reveal is one thing we can reveal is Django's not with Brumhilda. You know, of course he blew up a whole plantation full of white people. Mm-hmm. You know, he's basically he's basically had to kind of separate himself for her own safety.
Yeah. He basically dropped her off in like Philadelphia. All right, and she's working with the
abolitionist.
Yeah, abolitionist.
Yep.
She's literally on the cocktail circuit, all right, going down and telling her stories, all right, to raise money for the Underground Railroad.
Right, that was a very real ongoing business where people would do lecture tours to support the abolitionist movement, and obviously she would be a perfect spokesperson.
And meanwhile, Django's still a bounty hunter, and he's still really good. Mm-hmm.
By the way, this.
But he decided to stay out of the South. That's why he's messing around with the Southwest.
Moving to the West, yeah.
You notice she's getting closer.
Yeah, this nice girl here, whose birthday is, wants you to read her shirt, so.
Picture, please.
I believe you.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Hi, my question is for Quentin. I just wanted to ask you, you've done like a wide variety of different movies, all that have a little bit of dark humor to them. What would you say your favorite scene is out of all your movies, if you had to pick one?
It's like picking your favorite kid.
I actually think the two best scenes I ever wrote is the Hans Landa and the French farmer scene.
Yeah.
Of Glorious Bastards. And the first script I ever wrote, True Romance, the whole Sicilian scene. Christopher Walken and Dennis Hopper.
Just two guys sitting talking.
Yeah.
Fraught with tension.
Well, it was funny because it's like, I liked all the stuff I'd done after that, but it was my first script, and I knew I had never topped that scene, just as a scene was concerned. I go, well, that's definitely the one to beat, and I've come close, but I haven't topped it. And when I wrote the scene in Inglourious Basterds, I go, I think I finally matched it. And
you were lucky to have Christoph.
He pulled it off.
Nailed it, yeah.
But the thing is, though, is I ended up writing that scene, and then couldn't figure out the rest of the story, so I had to put the script away, but I always knew I would eventually finish it at some point because that scene was too good not to make.
Right. And, you know, and the joy of being a friend of Quentin's is to, you know, I remember when you were working on Inglourious Basterds and you invited me by the house, and he pulls out this spiral notebook and he starts, you know, reading and acting out the scenes. You know, and you were Hitler. I remember driving home and I go, and you have this incredible monologue with the Sam Jackson character, which is not in the final film.
Yeah.
You gave this speech, which was a Malcolm X meets Martin Luther King speech that just rocked me to my core. I remember driving home going, Quentin Tarantino is the best black writer in Hollywood.
What?
I'm waiting for me and my mother to absolutely love it.
Okay, happy birthday, Jamie.
Are there any other birthdays we should be aware of?
Yeah.
Like, you, sir. Congrats.
My pleasure.
Hi, Quentin.
Hey.
So as I was watching, and the scene that I'm sure for a lot of people, as myself, like, put over the top is at the end when he's like, the big climactic stake and then the Tupac track comes out.
Oh yeah, huh?
So I was wondering, are you a big Tupac fan? Were you dying to like write a scene just so you could use a Tupac track in it? And can you just tell us a little about that moment?
Well, the thing about it was, yeah, I am a Tupac fan, and he was a fan of mine. And I remember him and Snoop Dogg were starting a movie company, and they did a press conference announcing it. And they were like, yeah, we're gonna get like Quentin Tarantino to make movies for us.
We can afford it.
Yeah. And then when we approached Tupac's mom about using the rights, she goes, oh, no, he can do it because my son loves Quentin's movies. He would be happy as a clown to have his stuff in there. So that was half the reason she said yes. But actually how that track came in is when we were making our deal with the record company, they did a little kind of promo video to turn us on, to make us want to do it. And they put this unreleased track on it. And when the promo was over, we go, what the hell was that? And they go, well, that's this Tupac track that we own and whatever. I go, can we use that?
I go, well, yeah, if you made the deal with that company, you can. If his mom says it's okay.
And that's kind of how it happened.
You know, I mean, your choice of music and how you weave it in your film is such a vital part of your film. Mm-hmm. I need to talk to you. Mm-hmm. What do you think when you and I come up with a recommended listening list for each issue? Release it by Facebook or this.
Yeah. Well, in particular, if we, you know, if there's like you get almost like an opening credit sequence, yeah, of like characters riding with landscapes.
Yeah,
and
yeah, yeah.
Okay, take this Morricone soundtrack, put on track 3.
Yes.
Of the big gun down.
So you guys like that idea?
We'll have a playlist on dynamite.com.
Yeah.
There you go.
Thanks a lot, man.
Hey, Matt, I have a quick question for you. So Zorro is older, but is he fully retired?
Oh, no.
So this is not like he's putting on the, no, I gotta do it one more time.
The first line of the caption says, something to the effect of, and for some, the call to adventure never fades.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, now part of the plot is that things that by this point in his life, things in California have kind of settled down. So he goes looking for other trouble. He finds it.
And it's not just Zorro, it's Bernardo too.
Yeah, right, Bernardo. The vital part of Zorro is his relationship with Bernardo, his Alfred. And, in our narrative, they grew up together. For anybody that hasn't read the origin story we did, Zorro is son of a Spanish nobleman, but also a Native American woman. So he's half, he's mestizo, mixed blood. And and his grandmother's a shaman, and when they come of age, even though the father doesn't want it, he wants him to be raised as a proper caballero, the mother and grandmother send them out on their spirit quest. And when they're out, they separate, and Bernardo ends up finding the colt as his spirit guide that ultimately becomes Tornado, Zorro's horse. And Zorro, you know, Diego eventually comes staggering back to camp after days and days and days, and just feels like he's failed his spirit quest, because he eventually gets bit by a rattlesnake, and he got lost, and he never really found what he thought was. And it turned out this little fox came to visit him every night by his campfire and eventually led him back. And for anybody that doesn't know Spanish, Zorro means the fox. And so his grandmother says to him, no, that little fox was your totem. You must learn its ways. You know, the moon will be your mother. The cave will be your home. You will disguise yourself in the night as you hunt what can't be found. And so Bernardo and Diego are intricately linked, and that continues through the storyline as well.
Yes, sir. How you guys doing?
Good.
The comic looks awesome. I'm very excited reading the finished product. It looks great. Quentin,
One of the first departures that I've seen for you into non-traditional film is the awesome Japanese animation sequence in the first Kill Bill. That there's an extended sequence of that and that there's a ton of other footage. I know you've been asked this before, but when can we expect to see the whole bloody affair, Kill Bill?
Yeah, what's going on with that is, I originally, back when Kill Bill was going to be one movie, I wrote an even longer anime sequence. So you see, in the movie, you see her kill Abbas Masamoto, but then there was that long-haired guy.
Yes.
The big sequence was her fight with that guy, and Production IG, who did it, they also did Blood the Last Vampire and Ghost in the Machine, Ghost in the Shell. Said, look, we can't do that and finish that in time for your thing, and you can't have a 30-minute. Piece in your movie. I go, oh, okay. And so that was my favorite part, but it also it was the most elaborate and whatever. It was the one I was the most detailed on. But yeah, it's the one you could drop. So you know, we dropped it, and then later when Production IG heard that we were talking about doing Kill Bill: The Whole Bloody Affair, they still had the script. So without even being commissioned to do it, they just did it.
That's awesome.
They just did it, and they were like, we're just gonna do it, and we'll pay for it ourselves, and it's gonna be so great that you're gonna have to use it. And we kind of did it once, and because it was literally written down shot for shot for shot for shot for shot. And so they did it, and it's really, really terrific. And so anyway, the Weinstein Company and myself, we're talking about actually coming out with it maybe sometime in the next, not before the year's out, but sometime in the next year, they're talking about it. And then maybe even have a limited theatrical engagement of it.
You know? Or do you just let the chain loose?
No.
Yeah.
No, my job on the set of Django was to encourage the crazy.
Yeah.
No, you can whip him a few more times. Django's arm is tired, have him switch hands.
Yeah.
What's the problem? Yeah,
Django didn't look tired enough.
Exactly. No, I was...
There's still some skin in the Bird Brother's ass.
Right, exactly. That fire's getting low, here's some kerosene. And look, I mean, I'm editing it because there's no producer title in comics. You know, it was just, when we did the Django comic book, it was so great, and Quentin had the genius idea of not doing an adaptation of the movie, which didn't even exist yet, but to adapt the original screenplay with all the scenes that we, you know, had shot when would not be in the film or never shot at all. But it was all spectacular material. And again, we really wanted the world to see that whole beautiful script that he had written. So, and we knew this would be an adaptation that would be unique from any others before that. And so we just had fun. And I said, Quentin, we should not stop here. We should just keep finding more opportunities to work in this medium. You love it, I love it, let's keep playing.
Let me end this by you talked about the first meeting, and you were kind of, you know, again, Quentin and I got to get there right away. I was like, blah, 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 blah. I looked over at Reggie sitting there going,
yeah, best job in the world. I mean, I was there just to make sure that, you know, no one was giving each other the side eye. Yeah. But it was so love at first sight. I was like, my work, he is done.
I mean, Joseph, what's it been like for you, like, looking over this whole project?
Matt is one of my favorite creators from before I was working professionally in comics. Grendel, Mage, and all of the Batman stuff.
Yeah, well, may you clap.
Yes. So his work ranks up there with Watchmen and Dark Knight and all the other, you know, touchstones in the industry to me and to a lot of other people. And working with him on Zorro, and then now also most recently on The Shadow, has really been great. Matt's a great guy. He's a lot of fun to work with, and he's a true pro. And this thing's going to be great.
Fantastic. It comes out in November, right? November, six issues. All right, sir.
In print and digital, but I will go to your comic retailer and just put that on your pull list now.
Yeah.
Can't say it too early.
You want those variants.
You do want those variants. They are pretty.
Yeah, you want both those covers you saw earlier.
Hey, Nick, am I doing one of those?
I emailed you. You never responded. I said, hey, Matt, how about you?
I think so.
Who I guess
thinks
I'm
do a cover? Say yes. It's due Wednesday.
Awesome. He's so coy. We have
the world of comics.
We're afraid to ask him to do
it. Yes, sir.
Quentin, I just want to say thank you so much for coming out here to Comic-Con. This is a question, I hope you don't hate me for asking this, but I'm sure it's on everyone's mind. I was at your reading for The Hateful Eight, and are you guys going to green light that? And it would mean a lot if you tell me yes or no. I'll be on my knees for you.
Yeah.
He seems passionate.
Yes, we are going to be doing The Hateful Eight. Yeah.
Thanks.
All for you, buddy! I wasn't going to, but I kind of just decided right now. So, Reg, you've got to get that going by January. Can you do that?
I got it! Next.
Done.
Hey, Bane! How you doing?
Hello. How are you?
Oh God.
Hi guys, thank you so much for being here. My question is for Quentin, and as an aspiring I just completed production on a feature film. We shot for 2 years and we're now in the editing process, and my question is for you, when you were first finishing up with your first independent feature films, did you have any advice or experience you'd like to share about once it's done editing and when you're in that process of it?
Well, what I would suggest for any anybody who does an independent feature is first things first, try to get it on the film festival circuit. That's one of the most important things. That makes you legit. Enter it in different film festivals. There's festivals all over America, all around the world. Enter it into them, and then if you can, literally go to all those different festivals and just kind of. See how the film plays with the audiences, get to know the other filmmakers that are on the same circuit with you, the other different movies, and that's how I built my career. I was even talking to my agent the other day that went all around the world with Reservoir Dogs. I'd hardly been anywhere, barely left Los Angeles County. I mean, I had, but not that much. And then all of a sudden I was going to different continents. All in the course of 1 year, and a friend of mine said, hey, this movie's gonna be your passport to the world, and it was. And the thing is, from going there and doing press and meeting other filmmakers, that set up kind of my career. That 1 year on the film festival circuit, I think the same thing happened with you, Reggio, with House Party.
Absolutely.
It set up my entire career, basically. You know, especially the international career that I ended up having. So that would be my advice, man. Start entering it into film when you get it finished. Enter it into film festivals, and just go, 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 go.
Make a movie, see the world.
Break a leg, man.
Hi.
Hey.
So my question was, are we ever going to see a sci-fi or fantasy film written and directed by Quentin Tarantino?
You know, it's funny because if you'd asked me that a few years ago, I probably would have said, yeah, I don't know, it's not really my genre, I'm not sure. But you never know. I have kind of an idea. Would it be something I would be doing in the next year or so? But it actually is an idea. It's a little flower right now. It's a little bean sprout, all right? But those bean sprouts tend to turn into bean stalks. This would be the first time I wouldn't say, no, not really. This is the first time, no, maybe.
Yeah, right on.
It would be, you know, it wouldn't be actually, you know, it wouldn't be a spaceshipy kind of thing, you know, traveling through space, going to other planets. It would be more of a Earthbound sci-fi thing, but sci-fi nevertheless.
Hi, Mr. Tarantino, how you doing?
Hey.
My question is, originally you were going to do a Hateful Eight graphic novel. I was wondering if, I know that as you've announced, the movie's going to be made. Mm-hmm. Are you also going to plan on doing a graphic novel alongside with it, or has that been shut?
It wasn't so much a graphic novel. It was more like I was actually thinking of just publishing the script, basically. Mm-hmm. And either publishing the script or turning it into a novel itself. It wasn't going to be a graphic novel, per se. I don't really think The Hateful Eight actually works itself. The Hateful Eight is kind of just perfect to do as a movie and then to basically rewrite it as a play. I mean, I could actually see it being in the Samuel French collection of plays and people just putting it on. And I have to kind of have to restructure it the way it is now, but I've even kind of figured out how to do that. So I think that will probably be The Hateful Eight's other life, would be as a theatrical production.
If you could reboot any franchise and put your own spin on it, what would it be?
Oh, let's see here. Oh, are you a beat up Mia? Yeah. I have to say that a series of movies that I'd like to kind of put my spin on, in particular, would be Invasion of the Body Snatchers. Yeah. There's been a lot of remakes of it and everything, but I've got an idea that I think I'd kind of like to do, and I'd actually kind of, for the first time, like to take the point of view of the pod people. I actually don't think they're so bad. I actually want to take it from the pod people's perspective, and actually where you're actually rooting for the pod people.
Hello, panel.
Hi.
Quentin, I'm a big fan of yours and the reason I'm going into film, so thank you so much. It's an honor.
Oh, thank you.
Good luck. Thank you very much. My question is, above all your other projects that could have been comic books, what was it about Django that drew you to it the most?
Well, it was kind of the idea, it's kind of a two-part idea as far as like why I did the comic book and why I did the adaptation in the first place and why I'm doing this one now. Kind of mentioned it already, but let me make it a little bit more succinct. Was the idea, in the case of Django, and it was Kill Bill was kind of similar, was a similar thing to that as well. Most people, when they write scripts, they write these basically blueprints that are their blueprints that they're going to use to make the movie. In the case of both Django and Kill Bill, I just wrote big effing novels that I proceeded to adapt to a movie every single day on the set. I wouldn't recommend that to anybody. I'm a little bit old before my time. But it's an invigorating way to work, to say the least.
Django's also your most straight-up heroic film.
Yeah, no, it absolutely is. I mean, that was one of the reasons I didn't want to monkey around with any of the structure or anything like that, because that hero's journey was kind of important. If anyone ever actually read the script for Django, because it was out there online and everything, there was that whole big chapter that was Broomhilda's chapter. Well, I wrote that kind of knowing I would never shoot it, because it would break up the Django story, but I just liked it, and I wanted to know what happened. And I actually feel my scripts are meant to be read, and movies are meant to be seen, and they're not necessarily similar. But the thing about it was, as opposed to Kill Bill, which we get two movies, we're kind of able to use pretty much all the material.
In the case of Django, that went through that process, and it was great, but then a lot was thrown away,
as far as the movie was concerned. So the graphic novel adaptation was a way to literally use everything in the script, and even things that changed. Because I took stuff out, and that would change the story. But in the graphic novel, it doesn't, and it's just a full-on thing. I remember, if anybody read that graphic novel, I remember when we got the pages of the axe fight, where he kills all the trackers with the axe, and I was like, man, that was a good fight. Maybe I should have shot that. That was pretty good.
Let me throw a prompt in here. One thing I asked you when we first got together was about a character, Brunhilda.
Yeah.
Because Quentin's so good at writing, very strong, very heroic, very ballsy women, and Brunhilda is basically somebody for Django to rescue.
Yeah.
And you said.
Yeah, well, the thing about it was, I thought the fact that, in fact, some people use that as a criticism against her, that she was just a damsel in distress. And I go, well, she is a damsel in distress, and she's the princess. She's the princess trapped in the tower of the evil kingdom by the evil king. And it's Django's job as the knight to go save her. And
Schultz even tells that story.
Yeah, he even tells the story. And it's the idea that a black woman in that time could have a black man who loves her so much that after he actually extricates himself from a living hell, he will go deeper, deeper, deeper into hell to save his woman. And I thought that was a fairy tale that needs to be told. And men need to hear it, and women need to hear it growing up. But why I'm doing this one, though, is like I said, I don't really want to do a whole series of Django movies, but the idea of, like, Django was going to have many, many different adventures. And, like, I couldn't quite let it go enough to do a bunch of paperbacks by having other people do them, but I did like that idea, and this offered me a chance to keep control of the mythology and the story, but actually really tell a different story, a different adventure.
So could there be a follow-up team-up miniseries after this, if this is rocking out?
Well, I have to say, one of the things that we were talking about that I got a big kick out of is one of the things that Dynamite does with these characters that they've been putting under their stable. One of the neat benefits of it is now all these characters in the Dynamite universe all exist in the same universe.
And so it just actually just hit me just a few weeks ago. I go, wait a minute. So Django and Tonto actually exist in the same universe.
They could share some stories.
Yeah. So I could be down with a Django Tonto.
That just sounds like an awesome band.
Yeah.
Jam on it.
Yeah, I've been in line this whole time. I think you might have just asked the question I was going to ask.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I love Lone Ranger. It's my favorite title that I'm reading right now. And if there were to be a Lone Ranger Django crossover in the future, how do you see those characters interacting? Would it be like a Django versus Lone Ranger?
I like Lone Ranger, don't get me wrong. But I think there could be something really kind of cool about Tonto having his own adventure. I haven't thought 2 seconds about it other than when it'd be cool. That's as far as I've gotten. All right. But theoretically, I do like the idea of Tonto just being on his own in some adventure and him and Django bump into each other.
Back in the old days when Gold Key Comics published Lone Ranger, they also had a Tonto title. It was just Tonto's solo adventure. They also had a Silver title.
Oh, yeah.
Like the horse's adventures.
Oh, right? Yeah. Well, don't you do that. Like Trigger had his own comic.
Yeah.
Along
yeah.
with the and White Rod.
Yeah.
Silver
you
and
Tornado. The Alex Hoff ones?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thanks, man.
I just want to say thank you, everyone, for coming, especially Kent Quentin.
Oh, thanks, man.
So my question for you is, since you're amazing at putting minorities on the spotlight, and there hasn't been an Asian American lead in a long time, would you be able to, would you be open to rebooting some sort of Bruce Lee reboot, like a Game of Death, or putting it on Django Zorro Chen Zhen from Chinese Connection?
Yeah, Chen Zhen would be a good, he's a good character, mate. He's a good character. I don't have any plans on doing anything like that, but I could see it. I mean, frankly. The team up that would exist, that would be awesome, would be Django and Kwai Chang Kang. I mean, that would be the awesome one. All right, I mean, it's the same setting, it's the same era. Yeah.
Paul Warner's on Monday.
Right? Yeah.
You know, speaking of shared universes, Dynamite also has Shaft now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like, you know, yeah, you've got Django and Broomhilda's great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandson.
I think it works.
So that's kind of actually, that's the second sequel to some degree.
Kicking ass for six generations.
Now, I'm expecting at some point, you know, in your Shaft comic book, them to talk about, you know, great-great-grandmother Broomhilda.
Reggie will make it happen.
She was bad. You didn't mess with her.
Yeah, we were talking about, okay, well, when exactly did they drop the Vaughn from the name? The end of Django Unchained is hardly over, all
right?
You know,
right.
They have to fight their way out of the South, and everyone's looking for them, but, you know.
They're capable.
But yeah, but since Django will eventually meet Zorro, you know they do.
Hey, yes, Quentin. I was wondering if you were ever interested in doing a movie that wasn't R-rated, a little less gory, more lighthearted, and more calm.
Yes.
fuck no.
Tarantino Care Bears.
Yeah.
Smurfs 3.
To not do it or to do it. It's just, you know, you throw a couple of F words in and it kind of gets an R. And I,
so far, I've just always thrown a few F words in.
Guys, we're sadly near the end of this panel.
Oh, man.
So I don't know if there were any closing remarks you guys want to say. And
well, I'd just like to talk about real quick about the fact that our storyline, which Quentin kind of brought to the table, is actually, and I don't want to reveal too much, but the villain that our two heroes go up against is based upon an actual Western story that is so ludicrous it's almost comic booky in and of itself. And I don't really want to reveal a whole lot more than that.
It was really interesting because when, you know, Matt showed up, I go, well, look, he knows his Zorro universe forever, you know. I wanted to bring something to the table other than just the character, so I kind of thought about, well, what could be a good storyline without having to try to go through everything,
you know?
What could be a good setup, what could be a good villain, and then I had an idea for an opening scene, all right, and I was hoping that he would like it, and then one foot could fall in front of the other. And I remembered,
and that too was us sitting there going, yeah, yeah, and then blankety blank, and then
yeah,
blankety
exactly,
blank.
Yeah. And there's this one of my favorite writer directors is the director Sam Fuller, and he's terrific. Yeah, Sam. There's a good documentary called the movie Camera, the Rifle, and the Typewriter. It's really good. If you guys like Sam Fuller, check it out. Anyway, he did a movie that's based on a true story called The Baron of Arizona, about a guy who Vincent Price played him in the movie. And it's about a guy who tried to swindle Arizona out of the Americas.
Before it was a state.
Before it was a state. And so without really kind of going too much further on it, I thought that was a really neat idea for a story. So one of the things that we did is we watched The Baron of Arizona, and you see the whole thing laid out. I mean, it's a magnificent con what he came up with. I mean, it's genius. And so we watched the film and then just started web spinning on how that could work out and how he could work out as the villain and how Django and Zorro could be involved in this. And, you know, Zorro figures out that there's something up with this because the guy's very cruel and evil. And so that's how the investigation ends up starting out. And then Matt went out.
Yeah, our guy's more evil than the real guy.
The real guy was more of just a con man. Our guy is pretty bad. All right. But then Matt went out and did all the research on the real dude and the real thing of what happened. And he's come up with just a wonderful story and a wonderful arc for the whole situation.
So there you go.
First issue ships in November.